Keshiv Rehane, Deputy Micheál Martin, please.
Taoiseach, last week, or during the weekend, it was revealed by Tony Keneally from RTE that our revenue had undertaken very comprehensive and substantive work in relation to the implications of Brexit on the trading relationship between Ireland and the United Kingdom in the aftermath of such an eventuality. It basically said that there would be enormous physical and economic impact on our country and on trade, and that the impact on the customs infrastructure would be very significant indeed. 91,000 companies trading with the UK in this country, people who need to know this kind of stuff, the bread and butter of what Brexit could look like, people at the coalface in revenue doing very commendable work indeed in relation to the implications of Brexit. Enormous paperwork will ensue, enormous implications for human resources, physical space requirements, storage facilities in terms of importation and export. And of course, they make some very strong points, such as the very factual one that once negotiations are completed, the UK will become a third country for customs purposes and associated formalities will become unavoidable. And while this will affect all member states, the effect will be more profound in Ireland as the only EU country to have a land border with the UK. It says it would be particularly naive to believe that a new and extremely unique arrangement can be negotiated and applied to the EU-UK land frontier. Now, in essence, Taoiseach, this report was buried by you and the government. Our Brexit spokesman, Deputy Donnelly, Deputy Michael McGrath, finance spokesperson, Deputy James Brown, have tabled numerous parliamentary questions in relation to the work undertaken by revenue. What kind of work was undertaken? Have specific reports been published on the 11th of September to ask the Minister of Finance, Deputy Donnelly, if his department has conducted an assessment of the additional number of customs officials that may be required in the event of the UK leaving the customs union, if he will make a statement on the matter. Deputy Brown and Deputy Joan Burton as well have similar replies. And again, no reference in this reply to any internal work undertaken by revenue or a report of this kind and magnitude. And what I want to put to you, Taoiseach, is that in essence, your predecessor said he would share this kind of information with party leaders, he would share it with the Oireachtas. I see no logic or rationale as to why this report was suppressed. It's bad faith, Taoiseach, on your behalf and on the government's behalf in not sharing this with the Oireachtas and with the public, and with the general public. I see no rationale as to why it was buried in the manner that it was buried by you, other than it's the kind of story you didn't want to get out. The kind of negativity, maybe, it gives a harsh reality of what Brexit could be like.
All right,
to me, of huge value to everybody if we could have got it in time. But why, after parliamentary question, did you guys stonewall on this particular issue?
Taoiseach?
I read the report last week, may have been Monday. I certainly didn't suppress it. It's a report from 2015. It's a report done before the referendum even happened. And of course, a lot has changed since then, not least the commitment from the United Kingdom government that there won't be a physical infrastructure on the border and the negotiating guidelines that we've agreed with the European Union. So I can assure you I didn't suppress it because I didn't even know it existed until early this week or last week. And I have read it since. I've no difficulty with it being published. There's nothing in it that should be of any surprise to anyone. It's a desktop analysis done by the Revenue Commissioners as to what may happen in the event of a hard Brexit, there being a hard border, Britain leaving the customs union and we being unable to negotiate with them either a unique arrangement for Northern Ireland or a customs union partnership which would essentially replicate the customs union. And what it says should not be a surprise to anyone. If there is a hard Brexit, if there is no customs union partnership agreed with the United Kingdom, if there is no special arrangements for Northern Ireland, if we have that hard Brexit that we're all working to avoid, that would result in exactly those things. It would result in enormous cost. It would result in enormous bureaucracy for business. It would involve customs posts, border guards, truck stops, all those different things that we're all working so hard to avoid. Like, that shouldn't be a surprise to anyone. Nobody should be shocked at that. We've been talking for years now about the consequences of a hard Brexit, what it would mean. I've been to the border between the US and Canada to demonstrate exactly that, what a hard border would mean. And it has been our objective all along to avoid that happening. And we've been very resistant to any defeatism from anyone, including the opposition, to suggest that somehow this hard border is inevitable and we should start preparing for it. It's one thing to carry out a desktop analysis as to what may happen under certain scenarios, and that has been happening, and I've told you it's been happening. It's a total other thing. It's a total other thing for people to start making preparations for some sort of border that we're going to oppose, and we're going to oppose tooth and nail.
It's six times. We know about it because of RT and Tony Keneally, not because of you, and not because of the Minister for Finance. And the Minister for Finance was asked 19 questions by Deputy Donnelly on issues relating to this. Are you seriously suggesting you know nothing about it? The Minister for Finance knew nothing about it? And so he replies to Deputy Donnelly on the 11th of September. I am therefore informed by Revenue that at this juncture it's not possible to assess what additional resources would be required if the UK left the customs union. Are you seriously telling me that's transparency and telling this House the truth, when we now know from this report that the implications were deadly serious? Do you not think the traders and 91,000 companies need to know this kind of stuff? Do you not think the general public need to know it? The SMEs? Do you not think the British traders need to know it? The British public? They do need to know this. And stop being disingenuous, Taoiseach, about this as no surprise. The reality is, and Deputy Coveney, you told Deputy Donnelly you would share this kind of information with him and with other representatives, and you did not do it.
Thank you.
And I think the reason you guys didn't do it, because what you've all been saying for months is, in relation to the political rhetoric. The problem is, this buries the political rhetoric of the last 12 months. That's the problem. In other words, the frictionless border, all of that gets buried with this report, and it seems to me that people just didn't want it out there.
Thank you, Deputy Martin. The time is up now.
And as far as I'm concerned, government did act in bad faith, and you deliberately withheld the information from the Dáil in the form of the parliamentary questions that were asked and that were not properly and comprehensively answered as they should have been. Maybe a few of you went to some Jesuitical colleges, because the replies here are very Jesuitical indeed, for a reason.
Thanks very much. I haven't seen six versions of any report. I've only seen one report, and like I say, I have no difficulty with it being published. The first time I saw it was a few days ago. It doesn't, for example, to answer the question that you asked, it doesn't say how many customs officials there may be needed. It gives a range of somewhere between 100% and 800%. So these things are not necessarily calculable. But I have to say, Karen Coyle, I'm a little bit disturbed by this level of outrage. You know, because it doesn't seem to be genuine to me. Everyone since before the referendum and since knows exactly what the consequences of a hard border on our island would mean, and that's exactly what we're trying to avoid. Now, what I'm very confused about, I've never been one who's been talking about invisible borders and frictionless borders and telepathic borders. I've always said that that wasn't achievable. I've always said that there isn't some sort of technical solution to this or some IT-based solution to this. I've always said that the only solution to this problem is a political one, and the political solution is that we continue to have a free trade agreement with the United Kingdom, that the United Kingdom stays in the customs union, as I said in my speech in Belfast, or absent that, we have a long transition period, as I said in my speech in Belfast, or we have a unique arrangement for Northern Ireland. So I've always said the solution to this problem is a political one, not a technical one. But I'm actually very confused now by what the position of Fianna Fáil is. This is Fianna Fáil, the Republican Party. Is Fianna Fáil actually arguing now that we should start training up border guards, that we should start getting dogs ready, that we should start checking out sites for border posts, checking out sites for truck stops. Is this what Fianna Fáil, the Republican Party, is actually advocating? Of course we're doing desktop studies as to what may happen under the very many different scenarios that could arise from Brexit. But we're not going to do what Fianna Fáil seems to be suggesting, which is actually start preparing for something that we're trying to prevent. We're not going to be hiring dogs and training dogs. We're not going to be hiring customs officials. We're not going to be scoping out the border for a site for truck stops. And no matter how much Fianna Fáil demands that we should make those kind of preparations, we're not going to do that.
Yeah. It's very strange.
Point of order and leader's question. Deputy Adams, please. There's no point of order and leader's questions. There's no point of order and leader's questions. Deputy Adams. There is no point of order. Well, no, you can't. Sorry, Deputy. Resume your seat. Deputy Martin, please, you're being disorderly.